Hey. You startled me. I didn't have the video up, and I just heard yeah, and I was like, oh shit.
Yeah. Hold on, I'm turning on the original sound.
All right.
Yeah. Sweet. I'm just closing down some shit on here.
Yeah. I'm gonna share with the screen with you right now. Oh shoot, let's see. This is good why we're checking this. I've got some maps pulled up here.
Nice.
And I also got some pictures.
Oh, great.
Of people wearing the hat, at least the Kyrgyz and the Uzbek.
Oh, that's so cool.
Hat. Let me see here. Here we go.
I've got my husband on chicken duty.
Nice. Oh, good. I'm glad you brought that up. I think a cool thing to do when we get to that section would be to ask the kids who are tuning in what kind of pets they have.
Oh, okay.
And so we can just, you know, Jimmy says he's got a cat. I mean, what I've found out over the couple weeks of doing this is that the minute you mention the kid's name, like, they lose their minds. And totally. So any opportunity to do that, I think we should take. And maybe right. Do that before you bring yours on and be like, oh, cool, we got cats and dogs. Look what I got.
Yeah, I've got 8 chickens. that's why I was going to say I have a couple, like, In the Pocket kids songs, and one of them is Down by the Bay.
Mm-hmm.
And I was thinking, like, maybe at some point, like, 5 minutes before I sing that, if we can remember, we don't have to do this, but I was going to let them give me, like, you think of a thing, like a llama or a cow or an ice cream cone, like, and then right when I get to that part, hey, have you ever seen a... And you tell me, like, what they said, and then I can make up a rhyme to it real quick.
Okay, yeah. How would that shape, like, so would we do it before you're like, okay, we're gonna do a song, we need your help with it?
Yeah, this is the part that I need your help with, like, okay. I'm not quite sure, so I could say, like, maybe we would do it before we start talking about, like, I don't know, one of the things we're going to talk about, like the hats or something. So we said, like, hey, we're going to talk about hats right now, but coming up, we have a song and we need your input on that.
Yeah.
So then, you know, you like, we're going to do Down by the Bay. So if you have, you know, like, if there are 5 or 6, maybe 7 people who have an idea, you can read it out to me and then I'll sing it.
So do you think you'll pause in between verses? Be like, okay, here's some words, like...
I would be like... Oh, God. Be like...
I'd be like, down by the bay, where the watermelons grow, back to my home, down by the bay.
for if I do, my mother will say, and you'll be like, a bear.
Yeah, right.
Like, have you ever seen a bear sitting in a chair down by the bay?
Okay.
This might be a terrible idea.
No, I think it's a great idea. This is exactly the kind of stuff I want to be doing. So I will make that work. I think before the song, you could just, if you feel comfortable with it, you could just lead it and be like, okay, kids. Yeah, I think you were right. Like, give them 5 minutes to come up with some ideas and just drop stuff in. And then you can be like, okay, I'm going to start playing this song. And when we get to a spot, Ben's going to call out some of your ideas of things you want me to sing about.
Okay, cool.
You know, like, and we can tell him whatever you want. It could be ice cream. It could be cats, you know, and like,
See, my lizard brain, I'm going to have to be like, don't swear.
I know. Well, you said mofo yesterday. I loved it.
Oh God. In my brain, I was like, Celia. Yeah. What are you thinking?
I thought it was charming. My dad was calling me and he was like, she almost said motherfucker. I was like,
truth be told, I would never say motherfucker.
it didn't bother me at all. I thought it was, I mean, that's part of this is people want to see us being ourselves.
Yeah,
and, totally. And that's who we are. Be careful. Yesterday, the sound was amazing. Sometimes when you got a little intense on the guitar, maybe it was bumping against something. It didn't take away from it all that much.
Right.
Just be careful it's not hitting something, because I think whatever the microphones are picking.
It's that sound that you were hearing before.
It might be. And if that's the case, there's nothing we could do about it. But if you do notice that you're bumping into something, just avoid that. But it wasn't a problem.
And I probably won't be quite so like today. These songs are a little bit more like.
Yeah. whatever you want. I have the link for that word search that I'm going to drop into your Facebook right now so that you can have it if you want to share it while we're doing it. We're going to share it in Zoom and on Facebook throughout. But if you want to do it on your own at some point while I'm talking or afterwards, whatever. I'm going to give you access to it. Oh, okay, also, I'm going to share right now just some of the things that I'm going to share with the kids here. So here's the map.
Oh, that's so cool. So you can do this.
Right, exactly. And
that's amazing.
So I can also, I got to get it on my screen here because it vanished. Here it is. Here's Kyrgyzstan. I can back out. And
that's
be like,
such a great idea.
Yeah, here's Kyrgyzstan, and then, whoops, that was a little too close. But then Tajikistan, Uzbekistan, Turkmenistan, and then Russia up here. Mm-hmm. And so don't allow me to be the board with the map, and you can tell me what to do. You can be like, yes, there's Russia. Let's see what, you know, feel free to guide me when you're talking about the hats. On this, and also know that I've got these pictures of various things, and just so you're not surprised by them and have never seen them before.
Totally.
There's the one over here with the guys with the kalpak.
Some plov.
Exactly. You can talk about plov. Here's another Kyrgyz guy. Some kids from an orphanage. I think kids love to see kids. So there's like those six pictures, not too many, but I figured you were probably going to be like, we're going to show you hats from Central Asia.
Yeah.
And here's, you know, there's several countries there. And so now, you know, kind of what the pictures we have, feel free to be like, hey, Ben, show the kids some pictures from that part of the world.
Yeah.
And or I might too, if there's a break or something, be like, hey, Celia, let's show the kids some pictures. And I want you to talk about it most of the time. But if at any point we're, you know, like struggling for something to say, I think we're both comfortable leading this when we feel comfortable leading it, if that makes sense.
Totally. So. That makes total sense to
okay,
me.
Okay, cool.
Oh, yes. I love it. I'm trying to think if I have any great, like.
Yeah, I mean, if you've got stuff. you can share it too, because you're a panelist, and at the bottom of the screen, there's that share screen button. It'll pull up any window that you have on your desktop open, and you can share it.
Cool.
I should have, I'm still honing this. I should have told you that a week ago, and you could have had it ready. Okay. For the record, I've found Google Photos extremely handy for this kind of stuff, because you can actually search by location. So I literally put Uzbekistan in, and every photo I ever took from Uzbekistan showed up.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
I think I have some photos from Uzbekistan. Yeah, I think I do. I have a lot of movies.
Oh, I also I have the song, the same song pulled up.
Okay, great.
From Kyrgyzstan with those young women playing the kamuz and stuff. So if we want to do that, I think it's a pretty badass video of all of you guys playing and with some young women. I could see us thinking it was a good thing to show the kids. So.
I think so. I think that would be really cool.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, look, I guess I could share my screen with you. I'm just going to screenshot that real quick. Let's just see if I can do this. Share. So now you're in it, right?
Yep. I see your desktop. Yep. Oh.
Isn't that so great?
Yeah.
Kimber playing his fiddle and he's playing hers.
Oh, that's so cool. What a strange fiddle.
I know. There are all these funny photos I have in here. This was like an ambassador party.
Oh yeah, my favorite.
Yeah, I know, right? It was just is, and his name is Ambassador Crawl, and he was like, "You can call me Ambassador Cool." And we were like, "That's
oh no,
cool.
Oh no, dude,
so not cool." Yeah, there's a couple of good ones. I have so many photos from this time.
I know, it's hard. I've created some albums in Google Photos of just some of the best ones, because you never know when these when these opportunities arise. Your fucking TED Talk was just so good. I definitely want to ask you about that. Like, how scripted was that?
I memorized 20 minutes of material, and I have never memorized that much stuff in my life.
Yeah.
It took me probably, I knew I was going to do it in like July maybe. And so then I spent a while writing it, and then I spent a while learning. I'd hold my notes, and then eventually I'd put the notes down and I would do it. I did that damn talk for anyone who came over to the house, basically.
It's
I was like, this is what's going to happen. I'm going to talk to you for 20 minutes, and then we're going to have dinner. I did the talk for anyone who would listen, and I did it for my husband probably 5 times. You know, yeah. What I wanted to make sure was that story, I could tell it backwards and forwards with my eyes closed, and that it felt like I was just talking, as opposed to like this
exactly.
One time I went to, you know,
yeah,
like
totally.
I remember even there's a time in that I missed a line, and there was like a momentary flash of panic. I think maybe I'm the only one who can see this, but I was like, and then I was like, okay, but you know this story so well, that doesn't matter.
Well, you definitely, it was very impressive as somebody who. I think we're both pretty comfortable with public speaking.
Yeah.
I was impressed with it.
It was one of the most difficult things I've done. And I don't say that lightly, you know, like you've learned songs in other languages, you've learned this and that, but learning 20 minutes of continual talking when there's no music going on, there's no notes, there is a clock, a giant clock in the background counting you down, there's cameras everywhere, you've got your little stupid thing on your, like, that was probably the most terrified I have been in my life. I had to sit on the floor with my legs up in the air like moments before going on, just because I was so nervous, and I normally don't get that nervous. But when you know how it is when you are performing and you forget the lyrics to something, do the lyrics again, do the first verse again, and like this was not, you could not do that here.
Yeah. What do we? Aw. Oh.
They made us dance so many times.
They loved their dancing in Uzbekistan.
The drumming was the coolest thing. I wish I had. Oh, I might have a video of the drumming.
So why don't you? I'm gonna make this go live so I can start broadcasting it on Facebook. So stop sharing the screen and keep messing around and figure out a way to put some of that stuff aside so that you can share it when
I were to share that, I could just share the screen and then like press play. Is that cool? Or
yeah, that's how. But here's the thing: if you do that, go back to the share button for that video, and on the bottom of the screen, when you hit share, you click the thing you're going to share, and there's two little check boxes that says share computer sound and optimize for video. Make sure both those are clicked. If it's just a photo, you don't have to do either of those. Okay. But if you want to share a video, you want to click both of those.
Okay.
And I've had some struggles with it, so don't feel bad if it doesn't go perfectly.
Right.
People are, again, very forgiving, but just, and don't be afraid to ask me a question about it either during it. Like,
right.
This is so casual, and I think that adds to the value of it. So I'm going to go.
I forgot also quickly, do you want to just hear my guitar real quick?
Yep. Let's check that again real quick.
To say thank you, many different countries, there are many ways to say thank you. Jesus Christ Almighty.
So we are live now.
Oh. Whoops.
It's all right. You know Arthur Cyril? He just tuned in. I figured maybe he was one of your people.
Oh, I'm just gonna. I just spilled water all over the floor.
Aw.
The floor, that's why it's raining downstairs. We live in a log cabin. What Aww. Are you going to do, you know?
That's cute. Hey, everybody who's tuning in. We're getting ready to go here, so don't mind the relative unpreparedness of this section because it's not 11 o'clock yet. We're getting started. We're really glad you're here. Please make sure you drop in your name and where you're tuning in from so we can give you and any kids that are tuning in a shout out during the show, and we'll get started in a few minutes. Thanks for tuning in early. I'm gonna make this go live to Facebook.
Great. Hey, Phil, will you get the chickens in a minute?
Chickens.
Nope. I'm so sorry.
No, stop. You're fine. There's only three people in.
Okay, good. I'm just, I the rug is sopping it up here, so. Yeah, I'm pretty good down here. Okay, do you want me to throw you a towel? I got a towel. Just gonna clean this up a little bit.
Thank you. Yeah, I can get the chicken.
Okay, thank you. Well, that was exciting.
Yeah. You made a mess, huh?
I made a mess. Oh, that's why they call me Crazy Hands.
We're about to go live on Facebook. I know you're doing a bunch of things, but it will be shareable from the Prowlers page. I think probably right now.
Okay.
Yep.
Great.
Hey, everybody. If you're just tuning in, this is the Bluegrass Ambassadors Academy Junior for kids that we're about to get started here in about 6 minutes. If you have any questions, or actually we'd really love to know where you're calling in from or where you're joining us from and the name of the kids that are tuning in, so we can give a shout out to them. So make sure you drop it in Zoom or on Facebook. Let us know who you are and where you're coming from. Also, maybe if you have any pets at home, we'd love to know what kind of pets you have for something a little bit later on in the episode. So bear with us. We'll get started right at 11 o'clock. Gonna make sure I've got everything I need ready to go. My mother's here.
We got a lot going on in pre-production here.
That's okay.
Yeah.
If you're just tuning in, bear with us. We've got 4 more minutes before we get started.
Do you have a pet?
I do. Actually, ooh. he's right here. Shay. Hey, buddy. He's an old man.
Shay's like, yeah, okay, whatever, man.
Yeah, he's very much an old man.
Yep.
Yeah.
Excuse me. Okay, I'm not going to spill my whole glass of water this time.
That's good. More people filtering into the Zoom chat here. If you're on Zoom, you can drop who you are and where you're calling in from or joining us from in the either the chat or the Q&A section. Please let us know. We're also curious what kind of pets people have at home for something later on in this episode. We're getting started in 3 minutes. Let us know all these things on Facebook too. We want to know where people are watching from, and we'll give kids a shout out as much as we possibly can. We're going to get started shortly here. Feel free to share this stream on Facebook to help us get this to as many kids as possible. We know pretty much every kid everywhere is stuck at home. And we hope this is, I hear some interesting sounds coming from the other end of the computer here.
We could do it sooner rather than.
Yeah, absolutely. We could start with it. Or, you know.
We could, yeah. I could do a song first, and then I'm just worried you're going to hear all of this.
It's not that bad. It's not that bad.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Just let me know if you're like,
No. It's
this
cute.
This is hilarious.
All right. We're just about a minute away from getting started here. Very cool. There's already a bunch of comments coming out on Facebook.
Oh, great. Good.
Aw. This is great. Okay. Yikes. Okay. It is, we are just about to get started here. Before I give my opening spiel, please drop your name and your kid's name and where you're tuning in from, along with your pets. We want to know what kind of pets people have. Everybody has different kinds of pets. Let's make sure we get an idea of what kind of pets people have. I see people coming in here from, there's someone from Richmond, Virginia, Suzanne from Richmond, Virginia. I'm going to try to pronounce this, and he can tell me if I did okay. Gijsbert Ditweg, Gijsbert Ditweg from Rotterdam, the Netherlands. That's awesome. Okay, folks, my name is Ben Wright. I play the banjo in the Henhouse Prowlers, and we have a nonprofit organization called Bluegrass Ambassadors, and that is kind of what we're leaning on today and have been for the past 5 weeks and moving into the future kind of indefinitely. Every week we do an episode of what we're calling the Bluegrass Ambassadors Academy, where on Wednesdays, it's kind of a session for music lovers, and Thursdays, like today, it's a session just for kids. And we have picked out some of our favorite musicians from all over the world to kind of help us spend an hour together on each of those days and get to know them better and be inspired by them and learn about what being a professional musician in this world is like. And if you want to help us kind of pay for this whole thing, you can do so. You can donate to us. We're a 501c3 nonprofit. You can donate at bluegrassambassadors.org, bluegrassambassadors.org, or paypal.me/bluegrassambassadors. We are paying the artists. There's some production costs that go into this. Anything helps. It's okay if you can't do that. One of the biggest things that helps is just sharing this video while we're doing it live or afterwards, just to get the word out and hopefully provide some really cool content for kids during this interesting situation we're living in here. Again, this is happening every week. At the end of these, of both of the sessions, there's a survey that goes out if you join us on Zoom. Please fill that out. It helps us come up with new ideas and figure out what people need at home. We've gotten some great responses already. If you have any questions already for our guests, drop them into the Q&A section, either on Zoom or in Facebook. And again, I'll tell you, please let us know where you're calling or coming from here, the name of the kids so we can give them a shout out, and what kind of pets you have. I promise that's a meaningful, we'll get to that. So I'm gonna introduce this amazing person on the other end of the internet from me here. All the way from a small town in Maine, and she'll have to remind me what the name of that was, is one of the leaders in acoustic music in this country. Her band Della Mae has been all over the world and done a lot of the same work that the Henhouse Prowlers have done. And we've been to some of the same countries as musical diplomats. And I think that's part of why we feel a kinship with each other's bands. Sister and brother bands, as it were. Please make welcome on the guitar and her voice. She plays rock and roll. She plays bluegrass. She plays whatever she wants. Miss Celia Woodsmith.
Woo!
That's right. Oh, I don't have my clap thing up.
The applause button.
That's right. I'll work on that.
Thank you so much for having me back. This is a really special show. I had such a great time yesterday. For those of you who want to learn a little bit more about what I do and the places I've traveled, we have a really great video from yesterday up on, I think, all of the Facebook platforms and probably on the Academy as well.
Yeah, well, yesterday's episode was fantastic. And if you're itching to watch it now, you can go to the Henhouse Prowlers Facebook page and just scroll down a little and you'll be able to see the whole thing. I'm also going to chop it up and put it on YouTube in a much more palatable thing, not just the intro and the outro. Take those out. So yes, you can have access to those. But
well, thank you. Really, this has been such a nice part of this week and just preparing for it and thinking about what I want to talk about. And especially for this kids show, we spend so much time working with kids when we go on these trips abroad. And I don't know, it's just so great. I wish I could see all of the little kid faces right now, but you know, we'll have to imagine them.
Yeah, right. That is one of the most rewarding things. So, hey, can you, before we get started, why don't you sing us a song And after that, we'll kind of give a shout out to some of the kids that are tuning in or letting us know where they're coming from.
Great. So I'm going to start you off with a song today from an artist who I love dearly. And if you're young, you are so lucky because you have an opportunity to listen to all of his albums. We just lost him last week, and his name is John Prine. He writes really silly songs and really deep songs, really meaningful stuff. So there's a whole world of his music out there. And I kind of chose one of his sillier songs for you today. It's called Fish and Whistle. I've been thinking lately about the people I meet, the car wash on the corner and the hole in the street, the way my ankles hurt, the shoes on my feet, and I'm wondering if I'm gonna see tomorrow. Father, forgive us for what we must do. You forgive us and we'll forgive you. We'll forgive each other till we both turn blue. Then we'll whistle and go fishing in the heaven. And if you know how to whistle, this is a good time to do it. I'm not that great, but... not great. Maybe we'll try again. I was in the army, but I never dug a trench. I used to bust my knuckles on a monkey wrench. I'd go to town and drink, give the girls a pinch, but I don't think they ever really noticed me. Father, forgive us for what we must do. You forgive us and we'll forgive you. We'll forgive each other till we both turn blue. Then we'll whistle and go fishing in a heaven. Fish and a whistle, whistle and fish. Eat everything that they put on your dish. And when we get through, we'll make a big wish that we never have to do this again. Again, again. Oh, my very first job, I said thank you and please. Then made me scrub a parking lot down on my knees. Then I got fired for being scared of bees. And they only gave me 50 cents an hour. Forgive us for what we must do. You forgive us and we'll forgive you. We'll forgive each other till we both turn blue. Then we'll whistle and go fishing in a heaven. Then we'll whistle and go fishing in a heaven. Then we'll whistle and go fishing in a heaven.
Yay, I love that song. That's one of my favorites.
Thank you.
I want to give some shout out to some kids that are tuning in here. We've got Addie, Chloe, Molly, and Hazel all watching. They're all really excited. And not a day passes where we're not listening to multiple Della Mae songs in the house.
Aww.
Della Mae is Celia's incredible bluegrass band. If you've never heard of them, you absolutely have to check them out. Harvey and Opal are watching with their cat Theo and dog Esme. That's great. And Raina is watching. I know Raina, actually. Hi, Raina. It's good. I'm glad you're here. We've got some other ones, too. Milwaukee, Jeff from Milwaukee with his good buddy Mick, a 14-year-old dog. There's a lot more coming here. Somebody from Belgium at a pub called De Ballins that you guys played a couple years ago. Apparently.
Cool.
Yeah. Addie and Chase are here. Keep dropping. Oh, Della is watching in Chattanooga with her dog Trooper.
Oh,
that's awesome. So, do you have any pets?
I do have some pets. Actually, I have a dog, Charlie, who is watching right now. And I wish I could have a cat, but unfortunately, my husband and I are allergic to cats, so we can't have a cat. But to make up for it, we do have eight other pets.
Eight?
Eight pets. And they, right now, they all live in the basement, but I brought them up from the basement just to show you guys who they are because they're really funny and they're feathered.
What?
I have my husband over here and he's going to help me show you.
Cool.
All right. Here's pet number one. I'm going to put him on my arm, and maybe he's going to poop on me, but we're going to pretend that that never happened.
Wow.
He's going to speak into the microphone. This is actually a she. All of the chicks that we have are ladybirds.
Really?
And these birds are going to be laying our eggs for us, and we have 8 of these chickens, so we should at some point get 8 eggs a day, which is way too many eggs for us to eat. But this one right here, so there's all sorts of different types of chickens. Can you hear her in the microphone?
Yeah, yeah. Well, yeah.
This one is called a black Australorp. So
black, you, to me, hold on, let me see if I can get black Australorp.
Black Australorp, yeah. Wow. So yeah, they're from Austria. So international chicken here. There are all sorts of different kinds of chickens. So you might just know, like, I think when you look up pictures of chicks, you normally see like a little yellow fuzzball. But there's all sorts of different looking ones. So she is black with white feathers.
Wow.
She's really big, actually. This chicken is 6 weeks old.
Really?
So you can see this is my shoulder chicken.
And where do you keep them?
I keep them right now in the basement because they're a little bit too young to go outside. They have to be a little bit bigger because it's a little bit too cold up here in Maine to put them outside. But when they go outside, they live in a little house called a chicken coop. And you just kind of let them hang out in the chicken coop. And then there's something called a chicken run where they can go outside and sort of explore. And chicks are great because they eat ticks. And they eat a lot of other little bugs that might be a problem. So here, I'm gonna get you chicken number 2. I just can't wait for one of these chicks to poop on me during this.
Right, right. So when you got these, where did you get them from? Did you go to the store or buy chickens?
I did.
Really?
Okay, so this is, oh gosh, she's gonna be a little bit more chill here. Ugh. This is chicken number 2. This one is called a Lavender Orpington. That's a pretty fancy name, a Lavender Orpington. So I just went to my husband and I, right as things were kind of getting a little bit, you know, weird here, we went to the Agway, the local Agway, and we picked up 8 chicks. And they asked us which kind of chicks we wanted. Yeah, this one, I really love this one, actually. She's really pretty.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why they're called Lavender Orpingtons. And you can see her comb is kind of coming in. That's the top part that looks like a little mohawk on her head. Mm. And she's got these little, I think you call them wattles. And weird thing about chickens, I don't know if you can see her eye. When she blinks, there's another little internal eyelid that also blinks. They have 2 eyelids. So one is sort of translucent that covers their eye, and then they have the regular eyelid. So here's Miss Lavender Orpington. I'm going to give her back to Phil. We have 2 more chickens.
Is that her name, Lavender Orpington?
That's just the name of her. You know, I have a little 3-year-old friend who told me that he wanted to name one of our chickens Pablo. So I said, okay, why not? I don't mind naming. I mean, Pablo is technically a name for a boy, but that's okay. We can name a chick Pablo. So this is our favorite one, just because she's really nice. She's probably going to peck me right now.
Right.
This, her name is Noop Noop.
Why?
And this is just a buff Orpington. So there's Lavender Orpingtons and there's Buff Orpingtons. So this is the traditional sort of yellow chick right here. I think we like Noop Noop so much because she's really curious. You can see she's been the only one sort of pecking at things so far. She's pecking at the microphone.
That's awesome.
Chicken in a bread pan, picking outdoors. Yeah, she's really getting into it,
wow.
Huh? So she's also the smallest one, which is why we like her too, because she's sort of the runt of the litter. And you can see on her, she's still got some of her chick fluff. It's that fluffy stuff sort of coming off of her neck. there she is, Noop Noop. She looks nice, huh? She's a nice chick.
She's pretty. Okay.
I'm going to give her back, and we're going to show you the very last type of chicken that we have. And this one is called a speckled Sussex. It's a very British sounding name. Oh, here she is. Isn't that a nice looking bird right there?
Totally.
She's speckled. So, yep, she's going to sing into the microphone for you.
That's so cool.
So this is where we get all of our eggs from, which is pretty cool. And then when you go to the grocery store and when you get your eggs, she's also very noisy. So I'm just going to let you look at her a little bit. But, oop. Yeah. Wow. She looks like a little falcon, huh?
Yeah, right.
It's funny. They have this stable thing going with their heads. I just wonder if I could get her to do it. It's like her head almost stays.
Yeah, I see it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
It's like a little stability camera.
Right.
Yeah, when you go to the store and when you get your eggs, each one of the eggs comes from a chicken like that. So it's pretty neat to have them. I'm sure some of the kids out there probably have chickens of their own in their backyards. It's a really fun thing to have, and they're fun little buddies. They're maybe not the smartest things, but they certainly are very funny and endearing.
When do you think you'll get eggs from them?
We will start getting eggs from those chickens in about August. So okay. We got them in March. June, July. Yeah, they'll have to be about five to 6 months old before they start laying eggs. And so we don't actually know if there's a boy chicken in there yet. And that's what you call a rooster. But we're going to find out probably around 3 months. And this is what happened to us last time when we had chickens. All of a sudden, you start hearing this really funny noise. And it sounds terrible, but I'm going to do it for you. It's like, just like that. You start hearing that noise and you're going, which one of these chickens is making that noise? And you look around and you find that chick or that chicken, and it turns out they're learning how to crow. So that's the
right. That
sort of noise that you hear in the morning. Well, the chicks, they have to learn how to crow before they can do it. So they make these terrible noises for about a month until they figure out how to crow. So.
That's fascinating.
Yeah.
Shannon chimed in that Noop Noop was testing the mic.
Tech, tech, tech.
Yeah, right.
One tester. Well, I actually do have a song about chickens right now. This is one that I learned from Mississippi John Hurt, and it has a little bit of an educational component in there. So maybe some of you out there are super smart and you already know how to spell chicken. But maybe some of you don't, and you can remember this little song, and it will help you spell chicken in the future. So here it is. This is Mississippi John Hurt. I'm going to sing it twice so you can hear how you end up learning the word chicken. There's a verse before the chorus, all right? Chicken, chicken, you can't roost too high for me. Chicken, chicken, come on out of that tree. Chicken, 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 you can't roost too high for me. All right, here's the spelling part. C is the way to begin. H, the next letter in. I am the third C. What a seasonly bird. K, just to fill him in. E, I'm near the end. C-H-I-C-K-E-N. That's the way you spell chicken.
Yay.
So we'll do that whole little one part again, just because it's kind of fun, right? All right, so C-H-I-C-K-E-N. That's the way you spell chicken. Here it is again. C is the way to begin. H, the next letter in. I am the third C. Oh, what a seasonly bird. K, just to fill him in. E, I'm near the end. C-H-I-C-K-E-N. That's the way you spell chicken.
And that's, you said that's a Mississippi John Hurt song?
That's a Mississippi John Hurt song.
Very cool. Very cool. Hey, can you tell us a little bit about the instrument you're playing and, you know, I think it's important and cool that you're a professional musician. You travel all over the world, and you use both your voice and your instrument to make a career for yourself. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yes, I do. So this is a guitar. As many of you probably know, this is kind of an instrument that you see around a lot, especially if, like, say you have a singing group that you go to or whatever. This is a little bit different of a style of guitar. It's an OM style guitar, so it's a little bit curvier and a little bit smaller than a normal guitar. Normal guitars are a little bit bigger, and they're called dreadnoughts, so they kind of have a different shape, a little bit bigger. I love this guitar because it's a little bit smaller, and I don't know, it's a little bit lighter, easier to carry, but it's called a bourgeois guitar. So you can see the top there. Mm-hmm. It's a bourgeois. There's a lot of different kinds of guitars, and many people have their opinions on what is the best guitar you can possibly have, but really it doesn't matter. You can get any old guitar and learn on whatever, you know, and it's just fun. I will say, if you're out there and you're just getting into learning guitar, it took me a long time to learn because it is so frustrating at first, but don't let that stop you. You know, you can see my fingers have calluses on them from years and years of playing, but it wasn't always like that. When I was first learning, my fingers would get really sore, and I would be like, oh, this is too hard, I can't do it. But I'm so glad that I kind of pushed through and got these nice little calluses on my fingers. Because learning guitar has been such a wonderful part of my life, and I've been able to bring this guitar all over the world and play music for people, and just like I'm doing now, playing music on the internet. So if you are thinking you might want to start playing an instrument, any old guitar you have will do just fine. I just saw something pop up in the chat. Someone said they have a Yamaha. You know, you can have lots of, I started out on a Big Baby Taylor guitar. And so that was really nice.
So Tom asks, how long have you been playing? Tom in Kansas wants to know how long you've been playing. And I guess how old were you when you started playing too?
So my parents gave me a guitar. They noticed that I really loved to sing. And I kind of was drawn towards the guitar. And they gave me a guitar when I was 16 years old, and I think I played it for a while, but I got really frustrated. Like I said, I got frustrated with my fingers hurting, and I didn't think I could do it. So I kind of put that guitar away for a while, but then when I went off to college when I was 18 years old, I found that playing guitar was a great way to make friends and to, you know, kind of do new and exciting things. So I learned a couple chords, and I think I learned how to play Me and Bobby McGee by Janis Joplin, and I sat in the quad and I played it, and from then on I've been playing kind of nonstop. So I would say I got a guitar when I was 16, but I've probably been playing guitar now for 15 years.
It's impressive how little time that is and how successful you've been as a musician. So,
well, thank you.
Yeah.
I mean, you don't have to be fancy either. Yeah. You know, sometimes there's that feeling of like, if you're not a whiz and you're not taking all the fastest solos and this and that, that, you know, that may be something to be ashamed of, but I play three chords a lot of the time, and I love those three chords, and I can back myself up, and, you know, it feels great. So, you know, don't worry that you're not shredding solos like Jimi Hendrix. Like, you know, just play for yourself and play for the fun of it.
Yeah, I meant to bring this up with you later on. We do some bonus content, but I have this really great memory of one of the first times I met you was on a cruise. There was a bunch of guys playing bluegrass in a corner of the ship, and you showed up, and after about three really fast, fancy songs, you were like, guys, we're going to play a waltz. And you played three chords beautifully. You sang just like the heavens opened up, and you kind of put us all in our place in this really cool way. So I just wanted to point that out. It was a great, and I think that's what you're talking about. It's like there's you're being an artist, and it's not always about how fast and fancy it is. It's about how you present yourself and speaking from your soul, and you do that really well.
Thank you. Yeah, that's a really good way of putting it.
Yeah. You know, I want to point out, and this will help us segue into something else I want to talk to about you, is Raina just said that she wrote a song today.
Yeah.
And that's a big part of what you do as a musician. You write songs.
I do. I write a lot of songs. And I didn't start writing songs until I was 18. And the reason was, is I thought that I couldn't possibly write songs and that no one would want to listen to them and that, you know, that I couldn't put the words together in the right way. But, you know, I had a friend whom I met in college, and he said, well, do you have any songs you've written? I said, no, I don't think I can do it. And he said, oh, come on, just take the A chord and the E chord and write a song and call me back when you've got one. And I was like, well, okay, I might as well try, because if I don't like how the song came out, I don't have to play it for anyone but myself. So again, it's all about your own self-worth and your own, you know, your own happiness. Write songs for yourself and play the guitar for yourself. And, you know, you don't have to worry about other people listening to your stuff if you're not ready. But it's so fun to write songs, and I don't know, it makes you feel really happy. So I think there's not a better reason than that.
Can you share with us one of the songs you've written?
Yes, I'm so glad you asked. I'm actually going to play a song that I played yesterday on the stream, but for whatever reason, and I'm not totally sure why, for some reason kids love this song. Maybe it's the chorus, maybe it's something else, but I know I have this request a lot of the time when I go home to see my family from my little cousins, and this song is called Boston Town. Standing on the floor in the city of the spindles, got me a job, lift me up to the middle, the offering. Of the scripture, but a girl like me was a work to the bone. Your fingers bled and your body moaned 14 hours a day, and then my paycheck was half that of the men. Looking down with oppression's face, that pile of money they steal and waste. Then they said they'd to cut our pay, so we broke our cage and formed the FLRA. They said, what a waste of a pretty girl to let the labor flag unfurl. I said, what more can you take from me? I own my hands and my dignity. So pass me a match and we'll strike it. Boston town, we could start a fire and they'll never put it out, and we'll head back down to Boston town.
It's the dance solo.
I want to give a couple more shout outs to some kids and people that are tuning in. We've got Karina Bay in Eastern Long Island.
Hey, Karina.
And she said she loves your chickens. We've got Javier from Zaragoza, Spain, tuning in. And Oscar is here as well, who has the same pets, Harvey and Opal, that we mentioned earlier. Lucy from Gilbert's, Illinois, with her mom and dad and her cat, Mr. Snuggles. She's five. Lena and Greta are watching with their cats, Happy and Summer. Ollie here, age 7 in Blacksburg, Virginia. And then Jocelyn says, wow, to your song. And Andrea, actually, this is, whether you can do this or not, whatever. She says, oh, we adore this song, hoping for Bluebird, Blackbird.
Ooh, I might be able to do that at the end, yeah.
Okay, cool. So, you know, I think one of the things that you and I really appreciate about this and about what I was just doing, giving a shout out to all the kids that are tuning in from all over the world. And, you know, all over the world means a lot to us. I know you've got some things that maybe you can share with us that are from your travels all over the world.
Do you mean like things you put on your head, or maybe, are we talking about?
Maybe. whatever you want to share with us.
Well, one thing that I really want to tell people, you know, when it's safe to travel, obviously, when we can all start doing that again, traveling is so important. And, you know, some of us may have the privilege to be able to travel whenever and wherever we can, but you can also travel kind of on the internet. You know, you can look up really cool videos of what people are like in different countries and what people eat. You know, maybe you can ask your mom or dad to make you a meal from a different country. There's lots of ways to travel if maybe you don't have the money, or maybe like right now, it's not a good time to travel. There's so many different things to see and smells and colors and even types of clothing from all over the world. And even though people look a little bit different than maybe you or I look, they are all the same on the inside, and they have the same things that they want. You know, they want happiness, and they want to be around their family, and maybe they want to learn more about the world, and maybe they also like singing songs like you or I do. So just remember that when you see different people over the world, and maybe they smell different, maybe they're eating things that are different, maybe they have different things on their heads. You know, just remember, they're just like you. That's the basic, the one thing I have learned after all of my travels all over the world. You could really just distill it down to that.
That's such a perfect, I 100,000% agree with that.
Yeah. Let's maybe do the hat thing.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm just going to carefully place my guitar on the floor. All right, so I have traveled all over the place. I've been to over 50 countries now, and it's been a real fun part of my travels. And what I try to do whenever I'm in a new country is that I check out to see if they have any traditional hats. So we'll start out with a hat from Uzbekistan. And this is a hat that a schoolgirl might wear when she's going to school. So it came with these little pins on the inside that you kind of pin to your hair. And I think my head is way too big for this hat, and it probably will come up. But you can see, whoops, you can wear it a little bit jaunty. Like. So this is a hat that maybe a girl in middle school or maybe in elementary school might wear. So there's probably some of you out there who are of that age who might be wearing this hat to school if you lived in Uzbekistan. So look at how pretty that hat is. I think these are all handmade.
Yeah.
You can kind of see the stitching on the inside. Really neat.
Should I show the kids where Uzbekistan is?
Yes.
Okay. So I'm going to pull up a map here. And then, here we go. So here, if we back out here, you can see here's Africa over on the left and Russia up on the top. And Uzbekistan is in Central Asia, which is a lot of the countries that you've been to and we have too.
Yes.
So there's
Look at
Uzbekistan.
That. There's Uzbekistan.
Yeah.
Dushanbe is that the capital? No,
Tashkent is the capital of Uzbekistan, yeah.
Yep.
Okay, why don't you show us another hat?
Yes. All right. So I'll show you another hat from that region. And this is a hat that I think you have been, because we were in the same country.
That's right.
This is a hat that a man would wear. I always think it kind of looks like it's from Lord of the Rings or something. Really beautiful hat, and it's really warm.
It's a Kalpak. Yeah.
Yeah, say that name again.
Kalpak.
Kalpak.
Yeah, Kalpak.
I mean, what a beautiful hat. I wish that we had hats like this here.
I know, and they're warm, too.
My life would be so much more interesting if I could just go out in this hat.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I've got a couple of pictures of some Kyrgyz people wearing those hats. Hold on a second here. I should. Is this the map again?
Yep. Oh no! It looks like it wants to come up. I can see some photos of kids.
Yeah, I think I got it here. Here we go. So.
Oh yeah.
So here's a couple of Kyrgyz men in Kyrgyzstan wearing their kalpaks. And there's some plov.
Ooh, that's a very tasty dish called plov.
Yeah, right. And here's another Kyrgyz man wearing a different kind of kalpak, but similar, very similar. So very cool.
That is really cool. Yeah. Oh, man. Well, my hairdo is going to be a little bit messed up right now, but we're just going to deal with it.
Worth it.
Okay, so we're going to move along. I'm going to show you my favorite hat last, because it's clearly the best hat. But so I was in Russia about 2 years ago, and maybe we'll pull up the map again so that they can see where Russia is. But this is a special hat that you would wear in a sauna. So I think this gets pulled down kind of over your face a little bit so that you don't get like too hot or something or burned. But either way, this I thought was a very fun hat.
That is
kind of like a crown.
That's amazing. Let's show the kids where Russia is real quick. Again, I have to find my map, even though I know it's showing on your screen there.
Here it is.
So if here we get it with Africa over here on the left, and then Uzbekistan and Kyrgyzstan in the middle, and then Russia is this huge country up on the top of the screen. It's just massive.
It is giant. Look at that.
Yeah.
So. All right. Russian hat. Okay. On to the next one. So a couple years ago, my husband and I went on a long, long bicycle trip. We got on our bicycles in Geneva, Switzerland, and we biked down to Albania. And we biked through France and Italy and Croatia, Bosnia, Montenegro. And I got this hat in Albania. It's got the sweet patch on the front. I almost have to like bend down so you can see the hole.
Yeah, right.
Top of the hat here. It's funny, these hats looked a lot like some of the bales of, they made these really interesting kind of piles of hay. It was like hay, but they were giant and triangular, and they built it up around a central pole, and it just took so much work. A lot of the farming that they're doing in Albania is all by hand. They work so hard with like really traditional tools, all manual labor, and they made sort of stacks of hay that looked like this hat, but this was kind of a hat that you'd see a lot in Albania. So it's made out of like a lamb's wool sort of thing. So there's your Albanian hat.
Very cool.
And that's the symbol that's on the Albanian flag. All right. So we have one more hat to show you. And actually, Karina might know a little bit about this hat because I believe her father has one just like it, because I met her father in Turkmenistan. This is a Turkmen hat.
What?
Look at this. This is a very big and a very warm hat. Take it from me. You cannot wear this hat for too long. It's very cold in Turkmenistan during the winter. So you want to have a really warm hat like this. This is basically a whole sheep here. But I would say this is the pinnacle of fashion.
I was going to say that's my favorite, I think.
It's clearly the winner, definitely. Yeah.
That's cool.
But yeah, I mean, you might see some women walking around New York City with this hat. I mean, this is nice. It's really soft too.
That's cool. Let's look real quickly about where Turkmenistan is. I see it. I was a little worried that I would have a trouble finding it, but here it is right underneath Uzbekistan, to the right of Azerbaijan, and to the left of Tajikistan, right there kind of in the middle of Central Asia, which is the region we're talking about. Very cool.
Yep. So when I went on this trip about 8 years ago to Central Asia, I went to 6 countries. I went to Pakistan, Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, and Tajikistan. So 6 countries in 6 weeks I went to in that area. And it was one of the most wonderful times in my life. I really learned a lot of different songs. I learned a lot about different cultures and customs. And that's where I got most of those hats. So
very cool.
It's really great.
Yeah. So I actually forgot to mention this at the beginning. We have a word search with a lot of those countries in it that some of the other guys in the Henhouse Prowlers were drop in the chat here. And on Zoom and on Facebook that you can use after the live session today with your kids, with your parents, and maybe you might want to look up more stuff about those countries. They're all on the word search, and it's really easy to find videos about them on YouTube and learn more about these beautiful countries that, I mean, both you and I think had the same experience before we were asked to visit those countries. We had never even really heard much about them.
That's true. I didn't even know where most of those countries were.
Right.
But I'm so glad that I learned about them and that I got to meet some of the people, because they're really wonderful people and they have such wonderful hospitality. So it was just a great pleasure to go there and meet them.
Yeah. You got another song for us?
I sure do. And actually, nice. This kind of ties into some of the stuff we're talking about right now. Now, I think maybe some of the kids watching are maybe bilingual, which means they speak 2 languages. Maybe some are trilingual, which means they speak 3 languages. Maybe there's even more out there. I am barely bilingual. I can speak French passably. But there are so many different ways to say this one word, which I always learn when I go to every different place I go to. The first thing I learn is how to say thank you in whatever language of the country that I'm visiting, because it's very important to learn just a little bit about the people that you're visiting and how to properly express your gratitude towards them. So I don't know. Do you have the same thing? Did you ever like learn thank you and whatever? It's thank you and please.
Yeah, spasiba.
Spasiba. Well, I have a song now for you that I wrote that's kind of about the different ways you can say thank you. And I don't know, you can, it's possible you could, I don't know if you can share this song or not eventually, but if people are interested in singing
Absolutely.
It again or seeing the words that I used in this, I'd say there's about 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. There's 12 ways, about 12 ways to say thank you in this song in all sorts of different languages. So
very cool.
I'm going to play it for you now. All right, here it is. There are many ways to say thank you from many different countries. There are many ways to say thank you. How about one of these? If you're French, you say merci. It's shukran in Djibouti. If you're Japanese, you say arigato. In Brazil, they say obrigado. When they bring you your drinks in Russia, you always say spasiba. When you get your tostada in Mexico, gracias is the way to go. There are many ways to say thank you dose. Remember, it rhymes with mosquitoes. If Mandarin is what you're learning today, you can't go wrong with Sheshe. Rahmat in Uzbekistan. In Norway, talk as loud as you can. Say come on if your friend is Vietnamese. If they're Italian, say grazie. There are many ways to say thank you. In many different countries, there are many ways to say thank you. How about one of these? If you're in Warsaw and you don't know what to say, you can always try Jinkwie. It's Dankeschön in Germany. If you're Albanian, it's also try learning, please.
Yay, that was great. You didn't share that with me. I mean, I knew you were going to do a song about thank you, but that's brilliant.
I don't have anything else to do but write songs like this all day long.
That's really cool. Hey, kids, we're getting down to the last 10 or 15 minutes of this, so if you got any questions for Celia, make sure you drop them in the Q&A section on Zoom or on Facebook, and the rest of the band, the rest of the Henhouse Prowlers will transfer those questions to me. There's been all sorts of people tuning in from all over the world, including Ina from Holland, Jeremy from Charlottesville, Virginia. Bridget says Boston Town is her favorite. Lena and Greta are watching from Chicago. Kids album, my girls love it, as Amanda. So there's some really cool people turning in here. Please don't be afraid to ask any further questions. As I said earlier, I saw the word search get dropped into the chat here. So make sure you download that. It's free for your kids to kind of follow up after we're done here. I've had several other requests for you to play some. Here's some questions. Shannon asked, have you been to France?
Yes, many times. I've been to France. I was there last year. We played at La Roche Bluegrass Festival, which is one that you've also played at.
Not yet, but I know the owner.
Oh, you know Didier, yeah. I've been to France. I've been a couple of times to play, and I've also biked through France. I've biked, I don't know, probably 600 miles in France. Wow. So I got to bike all through along La Rhone, which is a river in France, and I got to eat lots of baguettes and croissants because I could eat whatever I wanted when I was biking 70 miles a day.
Very cool. Eamon just wanted to say gracias for that song, which I think is sweet.
Genada.
Bueno. Lena was asking who your favorite artist is.
Oh, wow. So there's a lot of answers to that question. I don't have just one favorite artist. I have to give a shout out to John Prine again because he was such an amazing artist, amazing writer, and just a gentle, good soul. He was a really good man. Other artists who I really, really love. I love Bonnie Raitt and I love Susan Zdesky. Gosh, there's a lot of people out there who I really admire. A lot of even my friends, kind of people in my cohort who are my age, who I just think are incredible writers and incredible people. So there's inspiration everywhere you look.
Yeah, that's great. Someone also asked, an anonymous attendee asked, did you write Boston Town?
I did, yeah. I wrote cool. Boston Town about these women who are living in Lowell, Massachusetts in 1820, and things were a little bit different in 1820. I think things were a little bit harder for a lot of people, and especially women. These women were pretty young, and they were working in these textile mills, so making clothing and things like that, and they weren't being paid very much, and they certainly weren't being paid as much as their male counterparts. So they were like, well, I'm fed up with this. And they went on strike, which means that they went and protested. And they stood in the streets and they made signs and they yelled out their thoughts about being treated with, you know, not equally. So it was those women were really inspiring to me. And it's really important to stand up for things that are right and stand up for one another. Stand up for your own rights. So that's what I wrote that song about.
That's great. Natalie wants to know, how do you bicycle with your guitar?
That's a great question, Natalie. Right. You know, my husband carried the guitar. We brought a mandolin and a guitar, and we put it on the back of his bike, and I brought a really small guitar. So I brought, like, I don't know, a guitar is probably... I don't know. I'm trying to think about how big it was, but it's like a half-sized guitar, and we strapped it onto the back of the bike, and somehow it made it through all 2,000 miles of our bicycle trip.
Hmm. We've got some really great questions about songwriting from young Chris here. I guess maybe we'll ask one of these, and then you could play a song and maybe ask another one before we close out, and you can finish with one song. So Chris wants to know, what was your first song about?
Oh, wow. That's a great question. I think the very first song I wrote was actually about... So I think I told you that story earlier on. A friend of mine says, why don't you just take, you know, two chords on the guitar and write a song? And, you know, you can totally do it. So I had been listening to a lot of, like, Bonnie Raitt and Susan Tedeschi, Janis Joplin. So I wrote a song about a breakup, like, you know, when you're in a relationship and you break up, and about how that person was going to miss me when I was gone. And that was the song that I wrote. It was not the most profound song, but that's okay. It was a song, and I wrote it, and that was the first step on this journey of writing thousands of songs. So that's my first song.
That's great. That actually doesn't sound as painful as other first songs I've heard. So that's respectable. Well, can you play us a song?
Yeah, totally. Cool. So I kind of want to play this for you. I've got a couple ideas, but this was an important one that I'd like to play you a song in a different language. Again, I played this song yesterday, but it kind of segues into another song that we can all sing together, which you probably know. The song that we'll all sing together is called This Little Light of Mine, I'm Gonna Let It Shine. And the song that I'm gonna sing to you in Urdu is called Lab Payati by this man in Pakistan. His name is Allama Iqbal. And the song kind of loosely translates into letting your own light shine throughout the world and letting your own love and happiness fill up the universe. So it's a really great message that I think ties directly into this little light of mine. So I'll sing it for you now and then sing along with your parents. All right, here's the song in Urdu. La peyati hedu aban ke tamanna meri zindagi shaman ki surat ho khudaya meri dur duniya ka meri dam se andhera ho jaye har jagah mere chamakne se ujala ho jaye la peyati hai dua ban ke tamanna meri
زندگی شم من کی صورت ہو خدایا میری.
All right, here it is.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Well, this little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
All right, the next one. When I see my neighbor coming, I'm gonna let it shine.
Neighbor coming, I'm gonna let it shine. Oh, when I see my neighbor coming, I'm gonna let it shine. When I see my neighbor coming, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
I'm gonna tell all of my friends I love them.
Tell my friends I love them, I'm gonna let it shine. I'm gonna tell my friends I love them, I'm gonna let it shine. I'm gonna tell my friends I love them, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
All right, we got two more in here. We're gonna go all around the world. I'm gonna let it shine. And we're gonna end with this little light of mine. Make sure you're singing super loud right now, because this is kind of the end, right? All around the world.
All around the world, I'm gonna let it shine. Whoa. All around the world, I'm gonna let it shine. All around the world,
little lights right now. Put up your fingers in the air.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Oh, this little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
Very nice. That was beautiful. Well, folks, we're running out of time here. We have some, hold on a second. I had one more question for you. What's the oddest or funniest subject you've ever written about? That was from Miss Little Chrissy Dollar.
Oh, boy. I think what do you think, Phil? That's it. So I just wrote a song called The Grocery Store Blues, which I'm not quite sure is totally fit for children's ears. Okay. But I did write a song about how difficult it is to go grocery shopping right now and how you can never find flour.
Which is frustrating if you want to make bread or pasta or anything.
Yes.
Which we finally have time to do.
Yeah,
I know this struggle. Well, folks, we're gonna close up shop here in a second. We're gonna let Celia take us out with one last song. Before we do, I want to point you towards how to get more of her music into your life, which I suspect you want that after this session. CeliaWoodsmith.com is a great place to get access to all of her stuff. There's also her band Della Mae, who are the incredible all-female bluegrass band that just cleans up wherever they go. Also, Say Darling. Say Darling, is it .com or I forget the webs?
I think it's just saydarling.com.
Yeah. Her rock band that also, as you can imagine, is a great time. So, you know, right now musicians are in a rough spot, and buying their CDs directly from them makes a huge difference. So if you were inspired or your kids were inspired by Celia's music today, please consider buying one of her CDs because they're all fantastic. And following her, all of her bands on social media too, so you can hear directly from her about what's going on. Once again, my name is Ben, the banjo player in the Henhouse Prowlers. Bluegrass Ambassadors is our nonprofit where we do kind of cross-cultural music education all over the world. This is our what we're doing in light of us being locked down. And we'll be doing it for the foreseeable future. Every week we have a new guest. Next week's guest is incredible fiddle and banjo player Jake Blount, who is bringing African-American influence back into acoustic music. And I'm really excited to hear what he has to say next week. So stay tuned for that. If you want, there was a free word search that was dropped in all the chats. If you couldn't get access to it, like if you didn't see it, feel free to email ben@bluegrassambassadors.org and I'll make sure you get a copy of it. I'm going to make sure Celia has it too so she can drop it on all her stuff. It's a great way to follow up with your kids on all the things we talked about today. Yeah, and please share this video. That's how this is getting out there. Feel free to share it on social media. Celia and I, in the next 24 hours or so, are going to get back on Zoom, just the two of us, and have a little bit more short, in-depth discussion about some of the places we've been all over the world. And I'm going to put that up on Patreon. So if you want to support what we're doing and get some bonus content, you can do that at patreon.com/bluegrassambassadors. One last time, CeliaWoodsmith.com. Please play us one final song on our way out.
All right, well, I'm going to honor that request. And this is Bluebird Blackbird, it's a Della Mae tune that was written by my godfather, Dinty Child. Here it is. Thank you so much for doing this with me today. It really makes me so happy.
Me too.
And I look forward to hearing from some of the kids and some of the adults who watch the show today. So here it is, Bluebird Blackbird, done without the beautiful fiddle playing of Kimber Ludeker. So here it is.
Bluebird sitting in a tree, go and find my true love wherever she may be. Oh, blackbird, blackbird, travel far and wide, let her know that she should be forever by my side. I'm gonna put my heart inside a boat, sail it way out west, send it far away to find the one I love the best, the one I love the best. And then I'll sew a net of golden thread, throw it out to sea, catch the one I love the best and bring her home to me, bring her home to me.
Dance party!
Well, oak tree, standing up so tall, if I can't have the one I love, I won't have none at all. Oh, acorn, acorn, falling for that tree, whisper in my true love's ear that she's the one for me. I'm gonna put my heart inside a boat, sail it way out west, send it far away to find the one I love the best, the one I love the best. And then I'll sew a net of golden thread, throw it out to sea, catch the one I love the best and bring her home to me, bring her home to me. Squirt gun, squirt gun underneath my arm, go and tell my true love I won't do her any harm. Yeah, fiddle, fiddle, rising up your bow, play for her the sweetest song you know. I'm gonna put my heart inside a boat, sail it way out west, send it far away to find the one I love the best, the one I love the best. And then I'll sew a net of golden thread, throw it out to sea, catch the one I love the best and bring her home to me, bring her home to me.
Yay.
Yay! It is!
Celia, thank you so much for brightening all of our days. One last time, make sure you go to CeliaWoodsmith.com. We'll see you all next week on the Bluegrass Ambassadors Academy. You're amazing. Thank you.
Thank you.
See you all soon.